In 1992, Arkansas Governor Bill Clinton defeated incumbent President George Bush by a landslide margin, beginning a new generation of American leadership. But Bill Clinton's first 2 years as president would be disastrous, resulting in Republicans taking control of Congress for the first time in 40 years. After that wake-up call, Bill Clinton quickly moved to the political right, supporting welfare reform, tax cuts, and balancing the budget. And by 1996, consumer confidence was up, and so was Clinton's popularity. Republican opponents of Senate Majority Leader Bob Dole would challenge his claim to the nomination, putting into motion a bruising primary battle, one that would see newcomer Steve Forbes spend $3 million in Iowa and conservative Pat Buchanan win in New Hampshire. Eventually, Dole would unite a divided Republican Party and take his message to the nation. In the end, however, a strong economy and a nation at peace would make this election cycle a dream come true for the incumbent president. Everybody, welcome to America's Choice 96. I'm Jim Heath. The story of Campaign 96 actually begins back on election night 1994. After 40 years of being in the minority, the Republican Party regained control of the House of Representatives and the Senate. Election Day 94 witnessed a GOP tidal wave that swept from east to west and north to south. In New York, liberal giant Mario Cuomo lost his governorship to little-known state senator George Pataki. In Texas, one of the most popular governors in the country, Ann Richards, lost in a landslide to George W. Bush, son of the former president. And in California, Pete Wilson, who at one time trailed his opponent by over 30 points, retained his governorship by a large margin. In the days leading up to the election, President Bill Clinton's popularity had dropped to an all-time low. Clinton was so unpopular that in many races, he became the issue. On election night, Arizona Senator John McCain spoke about the historic nature of the evening.
The chairman of the Ways and Means Committee is defeated. The chairman of the Judiciary Committee, Jack Brooks in Texas. Apparently the Speaker of the House is going down. It's so much bigger in the House. We expected to take control of the Senate, but over the country, it's just really been startling. I promise you, I will never see anything like this again in my life.
Now, is it too simple to say this is just anti-President Clinton?
I think it's anti-Clinton, but I think it's anti-Washington, anti-liberal, anti-regulation, anti-taxes. I think it's a whole lot of things, including anti-Clinton.
This looks like the worst case disaster for the White House, losing control of the Senate and probably the House of Representatives.
Well, results are still coming in, but of course we're disappointed. We would have liked to have won a few more of those races out there tonight. We're still watching some of the results coming in and keeping our fingers crossed for people like Senator Dianne Feinstein and Ann Wynia, who's running up in Minnesota, and we'll just have to wait and see what the final results are. But we would have liked to have won more races tonight. I think clearly the American people are disappointed in the state of government generally. I think this is a referendum on Washington and Congress and government generally. And I think the president clearly now will reach out to the Republicans, to the new Republican leaders, should that be the case, tomorrow morning, and look towards working together to start rebuilding this country, to reform government, and to get moving forward. It's not about moving right or left. It's about moving forward. That's the president's commitment. I think that's where he'll want to go tomorrow.
I think the issue was not so much reaching out to Republicans. After all, the president did reach out to the Republicans. We made an effort on the economic plan, and that was rejected. We made an effort on health care, and that was rejected. We were able to work on the NAFTA treaty, the trade treaty, together. We were able to work on crime and some other issues together. I think the real problem was that we had, obviously, a very ambitious agenda. We couldn't get it all done. I think the public, when they looked at some of the failures that we were not able to achieve, such as health care, they kind of drew a conclusion that things were bottled up here. And I think that, in part, contributed to the disillusionment that took place, and it was obviously reflected in the vote tonight.
We don't have the final numbers on the Senate, but assuming, or the House for that matter, but assuming the trends continue as they are, the Democrats lose control of both houses, is this president going to be able to get the remainder of his agenda done by the end of his term?
Well, the president's clearly going to reach out on a bipartisan basis to the Republicans. Every one of those elected tonight has to assume the responsibility that goes with that election in helping to lead this country and trying to solve the problems that are there, whether it's in welfare reform, keeping our economic recovery going, some of the political reforms that need to be made. I think those are the issues that the public wants to see change on. And I think the Republicans now are going to have to share some responsibility in trying to deliver on those concerns. They can't simply walk away from it.
People are wondering, since you will be the next Speaker of the House of Representatives, if all indications hold up, are you going to moderate your rhetoric in the interest of bipartisanship?
Oh, I think, you know, that when you're a backbencher or you're the minority whip, you have a style that reflects one level of responsibility. And you know, if you become Speaker of the House and you are given the honor of serving the country in that position, and I'd be the first Georgian to do so in 103 years, you know, you really, I think, have an obligation to think through, how do you best represent the House and how do you best represent serving the American people on behalf of your colleagues? And I think, you know, clearly Newt Gingrich or frankly anybody else would have to look at that as a very serious and solemn obligation. And I would certainly hope that I could grow into it. And I don't think that Newt Gingrich, Republican whip, is the same behavior pattern in terms of style and speeches and aggressiveness that you'd want to have in the Speaker of the House.
Was that a yes or a no?
I think it's a yes. I mean, maybe I'm too much of a history teacher, but I think it's a yes.
Okay, thank you, Newt Gingrich.
Thanks.
When Newt Gingrich took the gavel and became the Speaker of the House of Representatives, President Bill Clinton was forced to hold a news conference to declare that he was still relevant in American government. During the first half of 1995, Republicans worked with a flurry to pass their contract with America, 10 items that included a balanced budget amendment, a line item veto for the president, and dramatic congressional reform. It was at the height of this congressional popularity that Bob Dole would return to his hometown of Russell, Kansas, to once again, as he had done on two prior occasions, announce his candidacy for the presidency of the United States.
Something else I learned the hard way, that while self-reliance is an essential part of the American character, so is the spirit of community that reaches out to those wounded in body or soul. When I went off to war, it was to defend a community of values unique in all the world. I came back sustained by the love and generosity of friends and neighbors who renewed my sense of life's possibilities. And over these years, they have given me the opportunities for service which I can never hope to repay. And because they restored my spirit in a time of trial, I have dedicated myself to restoring the spirit of America. And so today, and so today, tempered by adversity, seasoned by experience, mindful of the world as it is, yet confident it can be made better, I have come home to Kansas with a grateful heart to declare that I am a candidate for the presidency of the United States.
Meanwhile, had to adopt everything the nation thought was good about republicanism, and then go further and paint the Republicans as extremists. The great repositioning of Bill Clinton began with a multi-million-dollar ad campaign that debuted in the summer of 1995 in selected media markets. The first television spot, aired on June 27th, telegraphed the president's strategy. Clinton would not be out-toughed.
An officer killed in the line of duty, a father gunned down at work, a student shot at school, a mother murdered in cold blood, victims killed with deadly assault weapons. Bill Clinton did something no president has ever been able to accomplish. He passed and signed a tough law to ban deadly assault weapons.
Deadly assault weapons off our streets. 100,000 more police on the streets. Expand the death penalty. That's how we'll protect America.
From this point on, every presidential remark, every gesture, and every action was pre-tested and scripted. With the invaluable help of strategist Dick Morris, Clinton then crafted a series of positions and actions that fixed him firmly in the center. In standing against Republican proposals to restrain the budget-busting cost of Medicare, Clinton appeared both compassionate and firm. He embraced the GOP's call for a balanced budget, urged a crackdown on tobacco advertising, called for school uniforms, and supported a series of proposals specifically aimed at women voters. About this time, the desire for someone else would reach out to General Colin Powell, the Gulf War hero. Just as the prospective candidacy of Mario Cuomo had haunted Bill Clinton 4 years earlier, so Dole faced in Powell a potential dream killer.
Well, sufficiently disenchanted then overall with the progress made under President Clinton and with his leadership that whether you run or not, you wouldn't want to see him return to the presidency?
No, I wouldn't make that judgment now. What I've always done is once campaigns get underway and sort of get to their climax, I measure the candidates who are out there and will try to vote for the best person. And unless I do become a member of a party, I'll hold that position for a while longer.
Is it fair to ask what your registration has been throughout your life?
I have never registered as either a Republican or a Democrat. I've always registered as an independent voter when required to register as anything.
Okay, let me be sneaky. Have you generally said, oh, that's the guy I voted for who became president?
I have told everybody, and I think as I go through the book, I tell you every time I voted. Voted mostly Democratic in the early years, then shifted to the Reagan-Bush teams.
In the fall of 1995, Bob Dole noted that General Powell was hot. I can't affect what he does, Dole said. I can only wait. Finally, whether it was his wife's well-known fears for her husband's safety or the general's own belief that he was unprepared for the job, on November 8th, he ruled out a run for the presidency.
For 35 years of my life, I served my nation as a soldier proudly and to the best of my ability. Since my retirement 2 years ago, I have written my life story and traveled across the country speaking and listening to my fellow Americans. What I saw and heard renewed my faith in our country, its people, and its promise. I also came away with a deeper understanding of the challenges we face, of the problems we must solve to reach the dreams of our founders. All of us have a role to play, and I have been giving the most prayerful consideration to the role I should play. The question I faced was, should I enter politics and seek the presidency of the United States? Many of you have encouraged me to do so. I have been deeply honored by the hundreds of letters I have received and by the hard work of grassroots organizing committees. I thank all of you for the faith and confidence you had in me. For the past few weeks, I have been consulting with friends and advisors. I have spent long hours talking with my wife and children, the most important people in my life, about the impact an entry into political life would have on us. It would require sacrifices and changes in our lives that would be difficult for us to make at this time. The welfare of my family had to be uppermost in my mind. Ultimately, however, I had to look deep into my own soul. Standing aside from the expectations and enthusiasms of others. Because I believe I have a bond of trust with the American people. And to offer myself as a candidate for president requires a commitment and a passion to run the race and to succeed in the quest. The kind of passion and the kind of commitment that I felt every day of my 35 years as a soldier. A passion and commitment that despite my every effort, I do not yet have for political life, because such a life requires a calling that I do not yet hear. And for me to pretend otherwise would not be honest to myself, it would not be honest to the American people, and I would break that bond of trust. And therefore, I cannot go forward. I will not be a candidate for president or for any other elective office in 1996.
Did you say that you would enter in the future, or you will continue speaking out? as a Republican. Why as a Republican? Why? What is in that philosophy that appeals to you that doesn't appeal to you on the Democratic side?
I'm very impressed by what the Republican Party is trying to do right now, trying to put the nation on a better fiscal balance, trying to bring government under control and make government smaller, trying to put more money back into the pocket of individual taxpayers. And I believe that they have ideas and energy at this time that I can align with. There are some aspects of the agenda of the Republican Party that I disagree with, and I have said so, and I will continue to speak out, and I hope the party can broaden its appeal to appeal to the greatest number of Americans possible. But that's where I think my interests lie and my politics lie.
Unlike General Powell, GOP heavyweight Pete Wilson, the recently reelected governor of California, would enter the presidential contest. But his campaign, with little organization or money, would end quickly.
But today's reality, whether for new citizens or for the native-born, falls far short of the promise. The tired have escaped foreign tyrants only to suffer the oppression of federal tyrants. My friends, you will never still this voice, try as you may. Some people are afraid to let the truth be told.
Pete Wilson would leave the race in January 1996 and endorse Bob Dole for the job. By December 1995, Americans were growing weary of partisan bickering. Sensing his chance to dominate the political debate, Clinton refused to sign the Republican budget. Republican leaders were stunned. The federal government shut down. Americans blamed the Congress, and Clinton's popularity zoomed up. On January 23, 1996, during his State of the Union speech, President Clinton declared that the era of big government is over.
We know big government does not have all the answers. We know there's not a program for every problem. We know, and we have worked to give the American people a smaller, less bureaucratic government in Washington. And we have to give the American people one that lives within its means. The era of big government is over.
That single line reflected a foreshadowing of his re-election strategy. Now, any prominent Republican could have responded to Clinton's State of the Union address that night, but Dole reserved the chore for himself. It was a bad mistake. Dole could have welcomed Clinton to the GOP and said goodnight. But instead, looking old, he prattled on nonsensically. It was literally too late for a new candidate to emerge. The filing deadlines for most of the primaries had passed, so the grassroots activists in the GOP turned to the existing mediocre field for an alternative. 9 GOP candidates were prepared to battle each other in Iowa and New Hampshire, and they were Lamar Alexander, former Tennessee governor, president of the University of Tennessee, and cabinet secretary of education under President Bush. Pat Buchanan, aide to President Nixon, TV commentator, and 1992 presidential runner-up in New Hampshire. Bob Dole, U.S. Congressman, a 1980 and 88 GOP presidential candidate, and U.S. Senator and Majority Leader. Bob Dornan, a former broadcast journalist, U.S. Senate candidate, and Congressman from California. Steve Forbes, CEO of Forbes Incorporated, American Heritage Magazine publisher, and chairman of the Board of Directors of Empower America. Bill Graham, former Democratic congressman, who co-wrote the Graham-Rudman Deficit Reduction Act, and U.S. Senator. Alan Keyes, twice GOP candidate for governor of Maryland, President Reagan's State Department, and TV commentator. Dick Lugar, former mayor of Indianapolis, manufacturing executive, and U.S. Senator. And Arlen Specter, former district attorney, former Democrat, and U.S. Senator from Pennsylvania. On a cold winter night in January, the GOP candidates debated in Iowa for the very first time.
Let me look, please, at my Clinton countdown watch. 373 days to the inauguration of the 43rd president. Subtract 76 days in the interregnum, and that means the election is 297 days away. It is very difficult for me to look at the man in the White House when, and I want you people in the monolithic, ideologically liberal, dominant media culture to hear me carefully. I, father of 5 and 10 grandchildren, believe Paula Corbin Jones. Now, do you know what that means? I think we have a criminal in the White House. The CEO of the state of Arkansas, who exposed himself to a 22-year-old state worker. What an outrageous crime that gives new definition to sexual harassment.
The way to avoid the government shutdown is to elect a Republican president who will sign the House Republican budget. That's the best way to do it. The way to avoid a government shutdown is to defeat President Clinton. And the way to defeat President Clinton is to move beyond the budget and outside Washington with our discussion. I'm glad to hear that so much attention is being paid to Tennessee over here on this side of the room. I'd like for everybody to know what my record was. And I'd like to see that kind of fiscal discipline in Washington. 8 balanced budgets, less debt, 6 out of 8 years, a AAA bond rating, almost every year the second or first best managed state. We funded our pension system with cash, and we have the 5th lowest taxes. And Steve, the only thing you've ever run is a magazine you inherited, and you raised the price of your magazine. Now, what would you do with taxes?
Governor. All right. Mr. Forbes, John Johnson of Marathon, Iowa, sent this question. Based on your current and projected income, how much would the flat tax rate save you over the next year?
There have been various estimates of that, from $100,000 to $250,000. But I've invested in my campaign 200 times that amount to get my message across of hope, growth, and opportunity. These diversions today from the politicians, you can tell they can't stand the idea that I'm going to take away their principal source of power and return it to you, the people. The fact of the matter is, under my flat tax plan, each of you as individuals would have generous exemptions. A family of 4, for example, would pay no federal income tax on their first $36,000 of income and only a 17% rate above that. That family making $36,000 today pays $3,000 a year to Uncle Sam. Under my plan, they'd pay zero. They'd pay no tax on pensions, no tax on Social Security, no tax on personal savings. By allowing you, the people, to keep more of what you earn, by reducing barriers to job-creating investments, America will move forward. I'll say it again, even though these politicians can't seem to grasp it. Every time we reduce the tax burden on the American people, not only has America moved ahead, not only have we created more jobs and better paying jobs, but also Uncle Sam, Washington, has collected more revenues. In the 1980s, for example, by the end of the decade, federal income tax receipts were $200 billion higher than they were at the beginning of the decade. Just remember, each dollar that Washington gives you in deductions, they find a way to take $2 out of your pocket. That's the way the system works, and I'm going to break it, and with your help, we will break it.
But this gets back to young people and the need for jobs. And since everybody's been piling on Steve Forbes here, I want to be fair, and I want to jump into piling on a little bit, Steve. Seriously, Steve, I proposed a flat tax 6 or 7 months ago. Let me tell you what's wrong with yours. Now, David Rockefeller could go down to Florida under your tax, retire, never pay a nickel in income taxes again, never support the defense of his country. That's wrong. It's unfair. We lose the mortgage interest deduction for the middle class. My flat tax is a middle class tax cut. Yours looks like one that was worked up by the boys at the Yacht Basin. Now, you also take away the charitable contributions. My flat tax would impose lower taxes on small businesses that create jobs here and impose new taxes on big businesses that send their jobs abroad and take jobs away from the American people. Let's get a middle-class tax cut, and you and I might be able to agree on it.
Senator Graham.
I think the way to deal with the guaranteed student loan program is recognize that 85% of the costs come from defaults, and let's treat these defaults as private debts. Let's collect them. Let's garnish your wages, and we can double the size of the guaranteed student loan program. 2 days ago, Bill Clinton said that Bob Dole should be praised for breaking with Republicans in Congress on the budget. He said that he and Bob Dole had been negotiating on the phone and that things were going well. I'd like to ask Bob Dole, Bob, is there some kind of secret deal you're cutting with Bill Clinton, and can you share it with us while we're here?
Next time you're in town, look me up. Maybe
you'll come back. Maybe you'll come back to Iowa and I can talk to you here. Because I'll be here campaigning. I'd love to debate this issue with you. But the point is, we're not going to be able to work out an agreement if we're going to try to cut the House out of it, if we're going to try to back away from the tax cuts. And I'd like to know, what is it you're agreeing with the president on?
Clinton.
Senator Dole, your turn for 60 seconds, please.
And now, should I answer his or hers? But
let's go back to hers.
Hers is a lot better question. She's passed every grade she's ever been in. So I can tell you that.
Polls in Iowa after the debate show Dole ahead, but newcomer Steve Forbes gaining quickly. Forbes eventually sunk over $3 million into the state by caucus day, a new record. On Larry King Live, Steve Forbes introduced his family to the nation and answered questions about why he was running.
How did this, when you made the decision, did you gather them all?
We did several times. It was sort of an evolutionary process. It began last spring when some friends approached me. So I discussed it with Sabina. At first, we thought it was very flattering. I did not seriously consider it. But when it became very clear there was not a pro-growth, pro-candidate, pro-opportunity candidate in the field, I began to treat it more seriously. So it wasn't one meeting, it was an evolutionary process over the summer.
And did you say, family, here's what I'm doing, or family, what do you think?
They knew what was on my mind, and so I had various conversations, sometimes together, sometimes individually, to get their thoughts. You can't go into something like this unless you have a united front back at home.
Now, Steve Forbes spent a lot of money to air television ads in both Iowa and New Hampshire, and most of them were extremely negative. While the other campaigns started off with more positive television spots, most were eventually forced to get down and dirty.
We have reached a defining moment in America.
Americans long for leadership, a strong president with character and courage who shares our conservative values.
Basic values like honesty and decency and responsibility and self-reliance.
These values form the core of Bob Dole's agenda for America. Reform welfare. Stop rewarding illegitimacy and dependency. Cut taxes for working families and create economic growth. Appoint conservative judges and abolish parole for violent criminals. One man steps forward, ready to lead.
Steady leadership for someone who's made tough decisions, for someone who's been a mainstream conservative for a long, long time, for someone who knows what made America great.
Tested in war, proven in peace, Bob Dole embodies the strength of America, a man every American will be proud to call president.
Friends, in recent years, middle-class wages have fallen drastically. Millions of our best jobs have been shipped overseas. Our greatest industries have been gutted. Yet Wall Street profits soar, thanks to Washington trade deals that sell out American workers. And because I tell the truth about their corrupt deals, they call me an extremist. Well, let them call me names. Stand by me, and together, let's elect a government that will look out for all of our people.
The presidency is serious business. The presidency is not entertainment. The president is commander-in-chief. He is that person most responsible for the security of all Americans. I believe that public trust is fundamental in the presidency.
Trust really has to be earned by a lifetime of performance and experience. Trust is not easy to come by, but it's essential in the presidency.
Dick Lugar, everything a president should be.
I'm Steve Forbes. The politicians are getting nervous. The polls are getting closer. We're moving up, leading a national crusade to change America. The politicians will try to stop us, but they can't. We want a balanced budget amendment that's a tax cut, a simple, honest flat tax, and an end to wasteful spending. Join our crusade. Let's send the politicians a message.
Steve Forbes, conservative for president.
For 17 years, Steve Forbes opposed a balanced budget amendment, calling a balanced budget bogus, and writing, "We don't really need a balanced budget amendment." As a political candidate, he shifted his position. No wonder. The Forbes plan increases the deficit $186 billion a year, raising taxes on working families. Bob Dole's fighting Bill Clinton for a balanced budget that cuts taxes and spending. The choice? Untested leadership, risky ideas, or proven leadership.
Of the three major candidates for president, two supported big government-run health care. One fought it. Two supported risking American lives in Bosnia. One didn't. Two supported paying unwed mothers to have more children on welfare. One wouldn't. Two abandoned their tax cut promises. One never will. Two say they'll change things in Washington. But only one believes in less government and more freedom. Only one. Phil Graham, president.
What's behind Lamar Alexander and his red flannel shirt? Lamar Alexander brags he balanced budgets as governor, but he doesn't tell you he raised taxes four times to do it, while doubling state spending. Running for president, Lamar Alexander collects $295,000 a year from his law firm that lobbies for special interests in Washington. Lamar Alexander, he won't change Washington. He'll fit right in.
With all the mud balls these other candidates are whipping at each other, I thought I'd take a minute to tell you what I'd actually do as president. I'd cut taxes and unleash free enterprise to create good new jobs. I'd help parents make our schools as good as our colleges. And I'd help us learn to expect less from Washington and ask more of ourselves. I'm Lamar Alexander. And if you're looking for new Republican leadership instead of mud balls, I'm your candidate.
The future of America belongs to our children. We owe them the right to life. Tax code that rewards work, marriage, and family. A fair trade policy that keeps American jobs on American soil. Safe streets, secure borders, schools that work. A culture that promotes faith, family, and freedom. That's the kind of America I want for your family and mine.
Bill Clinton is watching to see who Iowa nominates for president. If it's Bob Dole,
it's party time. Oh, yeah.
Or Phil Graham.
Four more years.
Or Steve Forbes.
Thank you, Malcolm.
But if Iowa chooses Lamar Alexander,
Where are y'all going?
So to complete the Republican revolution, just remember your ABCs. Alexander beats Clinton.
With the constant media attack on Bob Dole's record and character, the Des Moines Register asked in early February, how vulnerable is Dole, noting that he had slipped 17 percentage points in just 1 month. On February 6th, just 1 week before the Iowa caucus, a major upset occurred in Louisiana. Senator Phil Graham of Texas, who was expected to win all of Louisiana's delegates, lost a majority of them to Pat Buchanan. Now, 4 years earlier, Buchanan had challenged President George Bush for the nomination and received over 30% of the vote in the New Hampshire primary that year. The day after the Louisiana caucus, it was clear that Graham was wounded and Pat Buchanan invigorated.
Europe have just been told by AP that they have hard numbers, that they have people at each site, and that Pat Buchanan has won 13 delegates and that we have won 8. Even though I failed the third grade and had to do it twice, I knew after having done it only once that 13 was bigger than 8. So let me begin by congratulating Pat Buchanan. I want to congratulate him on the campaign he ran here. We did a good job, and obviously his supporters here, and he personally did a better job.
Buchanan Express.
Thank you. Well, my friends, the Battle of the Bayou is over, and it has ended in a great triumph for the Buchanan Brigades.
Now, polls conducted shortly before the Iowa caucus showed that the true winner would be President Clinton. Clinton would be the first Democrat in a generation without primary opposition in either Iowa or New Hampshire. Iowa Republicans, meanwhile, would provide Bob Dole with an anemic 4-point win over challenger Pat Buchanan. Dole would receive 27% of the vote, Buchanan 24%, Lamar Alexander 18%, Steve Forbes 10%, and Phil Graham 9%. Dole, Buchanan, and Alexander would each claim their share of victory.
Let me thank everybody on the stage up here, but more importantly, just say thank you, Iowa. It's twice in a row. We withstood a barrage of millions and millions and millions of dollars worth of negative advertising and came out on top.
Let me thank the people of Iowa for the graciousness and the hospitality with which they received us when we came into this state 11 months ago for the very first time. You know, we were strangers here, political strangers in this land, and you took us in. And now you are sending us out with the support of tens of thousands of Iowans, hard on the heels of Bob Dole in a state he called his own. The victory is tremendous, friends, and we are going to win this Republican nomination.
You've given me an opportunity. You've given me an opportunity to take this campaign across this country. A campaign about a rising, shining America. A campaign with a conservative vision of America's future that asks less from Washington and asks more of ourselves. A campaign about outside America, our everyday lives, about creating jobs, about rebuilding families and neighborhoods and churches and synagogues and schools. Honey and I and all of us in our family, thank you. And what we have to say is this. Thank you, Iowa. On to New Hampshire. Let the future begin.
After poor showings in both Louisiana and Iowa, Senator Phil Graham would drop out of the presidential race before the New Hampshire primary. Surprisingly, even though he had harsh criticism for Dole during the primary campaign, he quickly endorsed him for the job.
Senator Graham, does your endorsement of Senator Dole speak directly to your lack of support for Pat Buchanan?
No, I'm for Bob Dole, but not in any negative sense. I'm for Bob Dole because he is the candidate who can bring together economic conservatives and social conservatives. He's the candidate that can lead us to victory in November. That's the reason that I am for him. This is not a negative thing related to anybody else. It's a positive thing related to Bob Dole.
In New Hampshire, Bob Dole campaigned across the state as he had in two previous attempts for the nomination. Yet despite years of practice, Dole still couldn't say clearly why he wanted the presidency or what he would do if he got it. After his third place showing in Iowa, Lamar Alexander was emerging as the moderate alternative to Dole. A key Republican leader, Bill Bennett, the former Secretary of Education in the Bush administration and a noted conservative, endorsed Alexander for the top job. Steve Forbes, with his seemingly bottomless bank account, took to the airwaves for a 30-minute call-in show. Forbes was still reeling from his poor showing in Iowa and desperately needed to perform better in New Hampshire. Pat Buchanan, meanwhile, was quietly building upon the base of supporters he had put together 4 years earlier when he challenged President Bush for the nomination. The Union Leader newspaper, the state's largest, had endorsed him, and Dole's internal polling showed Buchanan as a real threat. A few days before the primary, the Republican candidates would meet again in another televised debate, and it was clear that Dole and Buchanan knew they were fighting each other for first place.
Well, let me address that this way. I do believe the Republicans have lost an historic opportunity because they lost a sense of vision in Washington. They got bogged down in the budget battle with CBO numbers or OMB numbers. Nobody could understand it, and they didn't stay on a high level, and they didn't talk about a vision and a philosophy of Republicans versus Democrats. On that level, we can win this battle every time. But you know, it's not simply Al Gore that's calling us extremists. My friend Bob Dole here, friend of 30 years, has an attack ad on me calling me an extremist. As Lamar said earlier, Bob Dole is a better man than the campaign his folks are running. He says in that ad that Pat Buchanan wants to give away wanted to give away nuclear weapons to our Asian allies. Bob, that's not true.
That's what you said. I didn't say it.
It's not true, and your folks know it's not true. And my understanding is now you're phone banking the same way you did Steve Forbes, telling folks Pat Buchanan said this. Bob, it's not true. Pat Buchanan is not an extremist. Those are the cuss words of the establishment. I'm surprised you'd be using them against a fellow Republican. And let me say this, Bob. If I'm an extremist, why are you pirating my ideas and parroting my rhetoric? Where'd you get that idea for the cultural war for the soul of America, my friend? Where'd you get these other ideas about corporate greed? Listen, I welcome the fact that you're coming my way, Bob, but I don't think you can call us an extremist when you've become a pretty good echo of Pat Buchanan.
Thank you, Mr. Buchanan. Senator Dole.
Well, I appreciate that endorsement. We shouldn't play on people's fears. We ought to play on their hopes and their aspirations. And I, too, remember what it was like up here and remember how much it's increased despite Bill Clinton, despite the biggest tax increase in the history of America, $265 billion, despite vetoing welfare reform and tax credits for families with children and a balanced budget. But in the interim now, there are about 600,000 people working in New Hampshire. There's been a growth in that about 51,000 over the past few years. So they made a lot of progress. The unemployment rate's about 3.3%. We've got about 1,000 companies in New Hampshire who export. They couldn't do that if you had Pat Buchanan's theory, build a wall around America, you couldn't export anything. There are people like Cabletron, Polyvac, Lockheed, creates about 35,000 jobs in New Hampshire. So all this high tech, all these things happening in New Hampshire and New England are on the plus side, and New Hampshire's on the move primarily because of an outstanding governor and the legislature working together, not because of Bill Clinton, because he, again, was an impediment.
Sure, NAFTA was really a wonderful deal for America. 2 years after we negotiated and signed it, our trade surplus is gone. We got a $15 billion trade deficit with Mexico. 300,000 jobs have gone south. The Florida winter tomato industry is on its back. Illegal immigration is soaring into this country. Mexico is the prime source of narcotics and drugs. And my good friend Senator Dole negotiated a $50 billion bailout with Bill Clinton for the regime that brought this all about. Why? Because Mexico needed the money to pay back Citibank, Chase Manhattan, and Goldman Sachs. Now, I plead guilty, Bob, to wanting to protect American workers making 10 bucks an hour in South Carolina textile mills from having to compete with Mexicans making a buck an hour. That's just not fair. That is un-American. But Bob, when Citibank, Chase Manhattan, and Goldman Sachs got into trouble, you turned into a protectionist with Bill Clinton and Mr. Rubin, Mr. Greenspan, and all of you got together and bailed out that government. Why didn't you let those fellas test the magic of the marketplace like you want American workers to do?
Thank you. Senator Dole, you have a minute.
Let me say, first of all, the problem is not with NAFTA and GATT. I supported the problem with President Clinton. He's been less than aggressive in effect to be an aggressive trade policy. He's got anti-dumping provisions, anti-subsidy provisions. We have provisions in law called Section 301 where he can take action to protect American workers. He hasn't done it time after time after time. As far as the Mexican bailout is concerned, and of course this is a position, Pat Buchanan was a free trader not too many years ago, used to write about it, used to read his columns, but he's changed his mind. We ship about $3 billion in exports per month to Mexico. Creates a lot of jobs in America. Now, if we didn't have the Mexican, so-called Mexican bailout was recommended by the chairman of the Fed, Alan Greenspan, and others, because had we not done that, there would have been millions and millions of Mexicans coming across the border that would increased our cost for health care, education, and everything else. You talk about an illegal immigration flood, this would have been a flood. It's going to steady off. It's going to give a little time to work. But if I'm the President of the United States, I'll use the weapons Congress gave me to make certain we get a fair deal in Mexico and the European countries.
But let me take up an issue mentioned by Senator Dole again. Senator Dole said if we hadn't bailed out Mexico with $50 billion, why, all these immigrants would have come streaming across our border.
It's going to be repaid, too, Pat. You know, money's going to be repaid.
Lots of luck, Bob.
We're not going to lose 1 cent. We took care of that.
Bob, you're not going to get a dime of that money back. Let me give my answer here. Bob said all these illegal aliens were going to come across our border. They wouldn't come across the border if Pat Buchanan were president of the United States. I would have a security fence across all those areas of mass transit into this country. We would stop illegal immigration cold because that is a constitutional duty of the president of the United States to protect the borders of America and the states of America from foreign invasion.
And I stood by from October 23rd when Steve Forbes started hammering me until January 12th. Almost 3 months, I took negative, millions and millions of dollars worth of negative ads. And he didn't even use a good picture of me. So, Steve, I brought some pictures. Next time you run one, use this picture. It's better of me and my wife.
good of her.
It's good.
And that's my little dog leader in this picture. He's the one on the right. So
there you go.
I know all about negative ads.
And this is
ads.
Elizabeth.
That's Elizabeth.
Knockout.
Right. So if you're going to use negative ads.
Senator, no pretty picture can get around what you did
on
taxes.
I know your problem. You got a lot of money, and you want to buy this election. But this election's not for sale. You hammered my positive rating from 80 to 13 in Iowa down to 54. That's what you did with negative ads. Nobody else has been the victim of negative ads up here except Bob Dole.
As he had in Iowa, President Clinton would travel across New Hampshire unopposed as the Republicans battled each other. And his message to the citizens of New Hampshire was clear. Think back to the economy 4 years ago and give me the credit for where it is today.
We won the Cold War. There are no missiles pointed at America's children. The elderly poverty rate has been cut in half. And if you live to be 65, senior citizens of America have the highest life expectancy of any group of citizens, seniors in the world. I think we got our money's worth. We can make a difference when we work together and when we determine to do things. If we meet the challenges of the future the way we met those three challenges, this country's best days are ahead of us. You can do it. Go Tuesday. Stand up for your country. Fight for your future and determine that we are going to do this together. Thank you, and God bless you all. Thank you.
New Hampshire has been the state with the first presidential primary since 1920. While it only has 0.4% of the nation's population, and 98% of that population is white, it has nonetheless done much to set the nation's political course over the last two decades. In 1996, there were 665,000 registered voters in New Hampshire. 211,000 of them were Democrats, 252,000 of them Republicans, and 202,000 of them independents or other parties. In recent times, no Republican who lost this primary has gone on to win the White House in November. The night of the New Hampshire primary, the GOP hierarchy and the press were stunned. Pat Buchanan won. GOP activists were sending a message that they were not too fond of any of their choices. Buchanan would edge Dole by only a percentage point, 27% to 26%, but it was enough for the press to declare the contest wide open. Lamar Alexander would have a strong showing with 23%, and Steve Forbes was way back with just 12.
Now I know why they call this a granite state. Because it's so hard to crack. That's why I love New Hampshire. This state's a tough state. Now, we don't know the final outcome of the race yet, but one thing I do know that it's a two-man race. It's a two-man race from now on. It's going to be a one-man race before long, but right now it's a two-man race. And we know that. And we know that we're now. We know that we're now. And we know that we're now engaged in a fight for the heart and soul of the Republican Party. That's what this race is going to be about tomorrow.
Thank you. Okay. We're going on tonight. Listen, my friends. I didn't think there would ever be a night. I didn't think I would ever have a night in American politics like that incredible night in 1992 when we met King George's army all along the Nashville-Manchester-Concord line. I didn't think it would ever be like that again. I thought it was the high water mark of the cause I believed in. We got a higher water mark, friends, and I'm serious. We got to buckle down and we got to move forward. We got to move forward with strength and courage and conviction and take what they're going to deliver to us. We know what they're going to do to us. They're coming at us every way. But you stay with me, say your prayers about this cause and campaign. I promise you, I will lead as long as I can and as hard as I can and as far as I can until we drop the torch and someone else picks it up. Thank you all and God bless you.
But this is only the first primary, and there are many more to come. And what I think America can learn from the young people of New Hampshire and the young people of Iowa who have overwhelmingly supported our campaign is this. There is only one issue. What kind of future will we have in this country? We can build a conservative vision of that future. And the message that you're sending tonight from New Hampshire all the way across this country is that the way to build that future is to remember your ABCs. Alexander Heath Clinton.
Having dismissed poor old Mr. Forbes last week, he indeed has not done very well. You said he was finished, and he appears to be. Anyone else you want to dismiss this week?
No, there's nobody ready for that treatment yet. There are some who might be later. You know, there were 43 candidates in this primary. Only three of them are still on their feet. Three Republicans and one Democrat who was not in the primary. President Clinton, who might be considered the winner. The Republicans opposing him are mixed up, fighting each other, somewhat confused. They have different programs, different policies. While he sits in the White House in regal splendor, in his carpet slippers, watching all of this and enjoying it.
Jack Kemp has long been a mover and shaker in the Republican Party, and as yet he has not endorsed anyone in the GOP field. The former housing secretary joins us now to talk about the race. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, Bernie, thank you. Pleasure to be here.
Why was Bob Dole sleeping at the switch in New Hampshire?
Wow. Right off the bat, Bob Dole had, in my opinion, a great opportunity with the Tax Reform Commission to come out of New Hampshire and Iowa with a message of growth and jobs and opportunity and helping make America in a new century and a new millennium the number one entrepreneurial capitalist country in the world, and also address simultaneously the concerns of social conservatives. He did the latter, but in my opinion, not the former. There's still time, but so far his message is mixed. And sometimes there's very little message at all. And I say that with great affection for him and a great belief that he's a patriot and someone who has done this country a great deal of service from his position as leader in the Senate. But if he's to win this, and I think it's not over, 3/5 of all the delegates will be picked in the next 5 weeks. It seems to me that this party of Lincoln and Reagan had better start sounding like Lincoln and Reagan, or else we're going to end up going the way the Whigs.
Because Bob Dole lost in New Hampshire, Steve Forbes decided to stay in the race and spend heavily in Delaware, side of the next primary. And just days after his fourth place showing in New Hampshire, Forbes won big in the Diamond State. On February 27th, just a week after New Hampshire, Arizona held its first ever presidential contest. All 39 of the state's delegates were up for grabs, and Pat Buchanan and Steve Forbes wanted them. Polls earlier in the year showed Dole ahead, but he would make a serious mistake in deciding not to participate in a statewide televised debate.
Mr. Alexander, on my way here to the debate this evening, I heard your comments at the airport chastising Mr. Dole for not showing up, but also saying that you were here in part to fight Buchananism. What is Buchananism, in your opinion?
Well, here's what Buchananism is, and let me contrast it with my own views, while my friend Pat is here, so he can speak for himself on it. Buchananism says, to create jobs, we build a wall around the country. I say the way we create jobs is lower taxes, lower regulations, and focus on education. Pat said, let's end, Pat opposed the Gulf War. I say we have responsibilities in the world. Pat would put tariffs on our trading partners. That put taxes on us. It takes money out of our pockets. I come from a real world background as the governor of Tennessee, as a university president, someone who's actually created a company that today has 2,800 employees. In Tennessee, when I began, we were one of the poorest states. We joined the world, we recruited international investment, we got busy selling our soybeans and our cotton and our Jack Daniels and our country music, and now our Saturn cars all around the world. That's the way to create a rising, shining America, not to build a wall around the country, put on tariffs, and have a future based upon protectionism. Arizona knows that.
I think I've got the drift. Mr. Buchanan, what do you say to that?
I would say to the former Secretary of Education, you need a little education, Lamar. Now, let me talk to you. Let me tell you what Buchanan's ideas mean. Basically, I propose the lowest tax rates on savings, investment, and income, of any nation in the Western industrial world, because we want money to come into the United States, not go out. Now let's talk about the trade policy. Let's talk about the trade policy. In dealing with communist China, dealing with England is one thing. Free and fair trade, a free trade deal. Same with Canada. Let's talk about communist China. Mainland China imposes 40% tariffs on American goods. It steals our intellectual property at will. It fires missiles at our friends. It tells us who we may and may not let enter this country. And it sells us five times as much as it buys from us. I would sit down to the communist Chinese and say, Mr. Deng Xiaoping, this might be a good deal for you, but it's not for me. And let me tell you, you are going to open your markets to American goods, or you're not going to get unrestricted access to our goods. If you're a tough man... And besides that, we don't like the way you treat dissidents and the way you treat women, so we're not treating you the same way we treat a democratic republic, because you are a brutal dictatorship, and we will deal with you toughly. And we got too many weak sisters in Washington, Lamar, who don't understand that.
Well,
why don't we go right back? I mean, Mr. Buchanan would put a 20% tax. Let me pick up
Mr. Dornan here. Mr. Dornan, I want to go back to a theme you raised in your opening statement.
Yes, sir.
Is this battle for the heart and soul of the Republican Party a good thing for the Republican Party? There's been a tremendous amount of rhetoric since the New Hampshire primary, and it seems to be incredibly divisive.
If we stay on issues, if we stay on ideas, if we stay out of Dick Gephardt and Bill Clinton's vocabulary, throwing the word extremist at one another, tearing one another apart. I was the replacement for Pat Buchanan on Crossfire when he went off to the hero of this party in this auditorium, Ronald Reagan, to work with him. We've all guessed it on Crossfire when Pat's been there. What are we going to do if Rush Limbaugh decides to run for office? Tear him up? Tear him apart? After these freshmen made him an honorary member of the freshman class, don't tear up our warriors. Pat and I disagreed over the Gulf War. We disagreed over how good an ally Israel is. But don't attack one another when we're all one team trying to get the corruption out of the White House.
Mr. Forbes, I have no question for you. Just pick it up.
Good. Let's
talk China.
Let's remember a simple thing. When you put politicians in charge of trade, the American people lose. We do have tariffs today. Tariffs are another form of taxes. When tariffs are applied, political muscle counts, not equity. America becomes less competitive when tariffs are there. Tariffs gave us the Great Depression, helped lead to the Second World War. The American people, when they earn money, should have the right to buy the products they wish from wherever in the world. This is freedom. This is freedom.
Bob Dole would spend little time or money in the state, and when all the votes were counted, Steve Forbes would win by 3%. Surprisingly, Dole would place second and Buchanan third. Dole would also place first in both the North and South Dakota primaries, although he was the only candidate to seriously compete in either of those states.
A week ago, they wrote our obituary. Now tonight, we can perhaps write the obituary for conventional political punditry in America. Yeah! I want to thank all of you, and especially the people of Arizona. Because what you've demonstrated here tonight and today is that when we get our message of hope, growth, and opportunity, when we get When we get our message across, the voters respond positively. That's what we've shown.
For most of the evening, the major television networks had projected Steve Forbes the winner in Arizona and Pat Buchanan the runner-up. As a matter of fact, CNN had reported early in the evening that Bob Dole would finish, quote, a distant third, unquote. Jumping the gun and making projections based on faulty exit polls proved to be, as it had in previous elections, embarrassing for the networks. CNN and ABC would both apologize to the Dole campaign the next day. As Pat Buchanan had dealt a fatal blow to Phil Graham in the Louisiana caucus, so did Steve Forbes deliver a similar blow to Buchanan in Arizona. Buchanan had invested precious time and resources in the state and had only a third-place finish to show for it. In late February, early March, talk of a brokered Republican convention surfaced as party elders wrung their hands. But Dole's team had astutely built a firewall in the state of South Carolina. The four remaining serious contenders for the nomination would debate one last time in South Carolina, and they would spend a lot of time discussing each other's negative TV ads.
I regret having spent so much time discussing my opponents when they made promises before an election and then routinely broke those promises after the election. However, in the last 2 weeks, I've concentrated simply on getting my message of growth, hope, and opportunity across to the American people, particularly in Delaware and in Arizona. I'm doing the same thing here in South Carolina and hope to do so for the remainder of the election. My campaign is based on the premise that America needs more freedom and less government. And I will not talk about my opponents if I can avoid it for the rest of this campaign. But I do believe that if they attack, I will respond. Thank you.
Senator Dole.
Well, I think Steve's been very effective with these negative ads. I saw my favorable ratings go from 80% in Iowa down to 50. And he spent about $12 million, I think, just on Bob Dole. He's the king of negative advertising. He gets a title without any contest. I mean, it's great. He can claim that title. But I think we ought to keep our eye on the ball. Our target is Bill Clinton. It's none of us up here. It's Bill Clinton. He's vetoed bill after bill after bill. So we have nothing but positive ads on in South Carolina television now. We have two very fine positive ads. We're going to keep it positive. I'm positive about America. I want to see America grow. We're going into the next century with a new president. The president's going to be Bob Dole, and I welcome you all to this debate.
Mr. Buchanan.
Well, I believe that, I think, Steve, you're right. You overdid it with those negative ads, and I think, Bob, you overdid it up in New Hampshire. And I think there was reaction against both of you on that. But I do believe there's something right about comparative ads. And the idea that pointing out that Senator Dole, as Steve Forbes did, has voted for tax increases repeatedly, there's nothing wrong with that as long as the ads are rooted in truth. But our campaign is a positive campaign. It's about representing the American people who have been left out and are unrepresented here in South Carolina and around the country. It is about providing a voice for the voiceless. And we've run a positive campaign. That's why we've done so well without the resources of my two friends on the right.
Governor Alexander.
Figuratively speaking.
You're
right.
Maybe. I'm glad to get the negative ads brought up, and then maybe we can get them out of the way.
You're running one right now.
If Steve is the king, Senator Dole is the prince, and your ads are on
you're
in South Carolina.
Right now,
now
me.
Bob, I'll let
Senator
me speak
Dole
during my time.
I'll give
Senator
you.
Dole in New Hampshire for his last 4 days took all of his ads off and ran negative ads against me, just me. CNN said they were untruthful, they were misleading, and they were distorted. Those ads are on in South Carolina today, they're on in Georgia, they were on in Arizona. You're also making telephone calls that are negative, as was done before, and you're passing out material. Now that's going on, Bob. That needs to stop. We need to be positive. I think you hurt me in New Hampshire, and I think you hurt yourself. And I think
Governor,
in the rest
up.
Of the campaign,
time is up. Time
we
up,
ought
Governor.
To talk about
Your
the future.
Time is up.
Thank you.
Bob Dole's chairman in South Carolina, former Governor Carol Campbell, would help deliver the state considered critical to capturing the entire region. Dole would win with 45% of the vote, Pat Buchanan 30%, Steve Forbes 13%, and Lamar Alexander 10%. The day before Junior Tuesday on March 5th, former Congressman and HUD Secretary Jack Kemp endorsed Steve Forbes for president. Political pundits were shocked. Kemp had vowed to remain neutral in the primary, but Forbes' economic message was straight out of Jack Kemp's book.
Having read that Lincoln said, I serve my party by serving the Union, I am convinced in 1996, as we are on the eve of the 21st century and a new millennium, that the best way that I can serve my country, to serve the Union, is to endorse the campaign in America of the candidate who has a platform of inclusion, not exclusion, that is progressively conservative, not reactionary conservative, that is predicated upon reform not only of the tax system, but of welfare, monetary policy, all of our policies having to do with the inner city. Steve alone has been talking about making America an enterprise zone from sea to shining sea.
Jack Kemp's endorsement came too late, and it did little to help Forbes in South Carolina or voter-rich New York. Bob Dole, meanwhile, would add to his own list of endorsements. Governor George W. Bush, the popular new governor of Texas and son of the former president, would jump on the Dole bandwagon the same day Kemp endorsed Forbes. Junior Tuesday would be a great day for the Dole campaign. He would win in Vermont, Connecticut, Massachusetts, Maine, Maryland, Georgia, Rhode Island, and Colorado. Just 2 days later, Bob Dole would win big in New York. And while Forbes and Buchanan vowed to fight on, their dying campaigns, without delegates or momentum, were clearly on life support.
We know what's going on up in Washington. We know the attacks that are coming, and they're going to be coming because they're frightened men up there. They're afraid of Pat Buchanan. They're afraid of you. They're afraid of the cause in which we believe. And that's what it's coming down to, my friends. We're not going to let the media establishment and the political establishment in Washington dictate again to the people of America. Never again. Who's going to be the Republican nominee?
By opening up and breaking up a political monopoly in New York, once again, in the years ahead, it's going to be a tough process, but at least in New York, with the changes that will come with opening up and having genuine democracy in New York again on the primary level, New York once again can become what it once was, the Empire State.
After New York, the rest of the primary campaign was anticlimactic. Lamar Alexander, after a disappointing showing on Junior Tuesday, returned home to Tennessee and endorsed Bob Dole. So did Indiana Senator Dick Lugar. And shortly thereafter, facing political reality, Steve Forbes reluctantly pulled out of the race. Super Tuesday on March 12th would be a blowout for Bob Dole. He would win in Florida, Mississippi, Oklahoma, Tennessee, Texas, and Louisiana. The Dole campaign had actually hoped that the state of California on March 26th would officially put them over the top for the nomination. But Dole's huge win in the Midwestern states on March 19th would do the job. After winning in Illinois, Michigan, Ohio, and Wisconsin, Dole would officially have 1,000 delegates, more than enough to make him the official nominee. But on the night of the California primary, Dole would declare victory, and Republicans knew they had their man for 1996. Throughout most of the winter and spring of 96, the Dole campaign tried to paint their candidate as a man of the people. He was from Midwestern roots, they said, a young man who had bravely fought for his country, then served honorably in politics, and never forgotten who had helped him. It was an emotional moment when Bob Dole, after years of waiting, returned to his boyhood hometown of Russell, Kansas, as the Republican nominee for President of the United States.
So by most accounts, I now have enough delegates to be the Republican nominee for President of the United States. And tomorrow I will add enough to erase any doubt. So at this moment, I wanted to be home, to come to this place. And to see all of my friends. And all the people that I owe so much.
In 1992, billionaire Ross Perot emerged as a legitimate third-party candidate. He seemed remarkably blunt at a time when Americans distrusted their government and worried about their economic future. And on election day, he would garner a remarkable 19 million votes. In 1996, Ross Perot decided to compete once again. However, unlike 4 years earlier, Perot was viewed more skeptically. By accepting $29 million in taxpayer money to fund his presidential campaign, he was considered just another politician. And his credibility, both as an outsider and as a deficit hawk, was undermined. Perot would still capture 8% of the vote in November, and help create a bona fide third party whose presidential candidate in the year 2000 will qualify for taxpayer funding. As a grueling primary campaign came to an end, the Dole campaign was both broke and exhausted. It was about this time that the Clinton camp, flush with funds because no other Democrat had risen to challenge the president, filled the airwaves with a massive TV ad strategy that would define the coming general election debate. Let Dole have the White House, the Democrats argued, and unpopular Speaker of the House Newt Gingrich will be running the country. Let us keep it, and Bill Clinton will put the brakes on the Gingrich revolution.
The Oval Office. If Dole sits here and Gingrich runs Congress, what could happen? Medicare slashed, women's right to choose gone, education, school drug programs cut, and a risky $550 billion plan balloons the deficit, raises interest rates, hurts the economy. President Clinton says balance the budget, cut taxes for families, college tuition, stands up to Dole and Gingrich. But if Dole wins and Gingrich runs Congress, there'll be nobody there to stop them.
Any challenger to Bill Clinton in 1996 would have had an uphill climb. When the economy is growing, consumer confidence is soaring, and the country is not at war, the incumbent always benefits. And so it was in May of 96 that Bob Dole found himself 15 to 20 points behind President Clinton in public opinion polls. His campaign was wounded after a nasty and costly primary fight. He was unable to counteract the massive TV blitz that the Democrats had initiated. And the solid economic picture, for the first time in decades, favored an incumbent Democrat president. Dole needed to make a bold move to get back in the race, and he came up with a masterstroke. In perhaps the most dramatic moment of the campaign, he shocked everyone and announced that he was resigning from the U.S. Senate.
Therefore, as the campaign for the presidency begins in earnest, it is my obligation to the Senate and to the people of America to leave behind all the trappings of power, all comfort, and all security. So today I announce that I will forgo the privileges, not only the office of the Majority Leader, but of the United States Senate itself, from which I resign effective on or before June the 11th. And I will then stand before you without office or authority, a private citizen, a Kansan, an American, just a man. But I will be the same man I was when I walked into the room. The same man I was yesterday and the day before and a long time ago when I rose from my hospital bed and was permitted by the grace of God to walk again in the world. And I trust in the hard way, for little has come to me except in the hard way, which is good because we have a hard task ahead of us. We are gaining but still behind in the polls. The press does not lean our way. And many Beltway pundits confidently dismiss my chances of victory. I do not find this disheartening. I do not find it discouraging. For this is where I touch the ground. And it is in touching the ground in moments of difficulty that I've always found my strength. I have been there before. I have done it the hard way. And I will do it the hard way once again. We're leaving this year, and I'm only one. I know we have the same thoughts and the same emotions. If we could all go out and shake hands of all the people who are responsible for us being here, it would take a long, long time. You begin with your family. You obviously begin with your parents, your brothers, your sisters. And you think about all the support they provided and all the good things that happened. And you think about the Senate. So the Bible tells us to everything there is a season. And I think my season in the Senate is about to come to an end. But the new season before me makes this moment far less the closing of one chapter than the opening of another.
1996 Republican National Convention was held in San Diego, California, the week of August 12th. After choosing Jack Kemp, the Dole campaign seemed revitalized. GOP delegates were excited, and there was a sense that this election might be winnable after all. And while there was the usual squabbling over platform positions, particularly on the issue of abortion, the convention that Americans viewed on primetime TV was well organized. The opening night of the convention, a huge ratings winner, featured an emotional tribute to former President Ronald Reagan and a powerful speech by General Colin Powell.
After I was shot down in Bosnia and finally rescued after 6 days, the first person to write me and wish me well was President Reagan. He even sent me a jar of jelly beans. But I wasn't surprised. I know how much America's military meant to him. He supported us. He respected us. He was proud of us. He loved us. And of all the wonderful things he did as president, the one I'll always remember is that he gave us back our pride, our strength, our spirit.
It looks good.
Sir, my name is Private First Class Bruner. I'm from Malibu, California, and I've been in Korea 7 months, sir.
California.
Yes, sir.
Well, proud to know you.
Proud to know you too, sir.
He was the most positive, uplifting person I've ever been around. He set an example that this country hadn't had in a long time.
Mr. President, you were like the guys you played in the movies. You're a hero.
And here's to the Gipper. Thank you, Mr. President, for all you did for America and the whole wide world.
Mr. President, you did a lot for your country, and your country will never forget you.
President Reagan, from all of us in the armed forces, we salute you.
Thank you, President Reagan, for the twinkle in your eye and the firmness of your purpose.
I wanted to give this personal word to President and Mrs. Reagan, who may be watching. I want to say, may God bless you always.
I guess we did okay.
Just 4 years ago, Ronnie stood before you and spoke for what he said might be his last speech at a Republican convention. Sadly, his words were too prophetic. Sorry. When we learned of his illness, Alzheimer's, he made the decision to write his letter to the American people, and the people responded, as they always do. I can't tell you what your cards and letters have meant to both of us. The love and affection from thousands of Americans has been and continues to be a strengthening force for Ronnie and me each and every day. We've learned, as too many other families have learned, of the terrible pain and loneliness that must be endured as each day brings another reminder of this very long goodbye.
I became a Republican because I believe, like you, that the federal government has become too large and too intrusive in our lives. We can no longer afford solutions to our problems that result in more entitlements, higher taxes to pay for them, more bureaucracy to run them, and fewer results to show for it. I became a Republican because I believe America must remain the leader of the free world. Republican leadership, a Republican president, will bring greater conviction and coherence to our foreign policy and will guarantee that our armed forces remain the strongest and most capable on earth. I became a Republican. I became a Republican because I want to help fill the big tent that our party has raised to attract all Americans. You all know that I believe in a woman's right to choose, and I strongly support affirmative action. And I was invited here by my party to share my views with you. because we are a big enough party and big enough people to disagree on individual issues and still work together for our common goal, restoring the American dream.
Up America to President Clinton and his high taxing, free spending, promise breaking, Social Security taxing, health care socializing, drug coddling, power grabbing, business busting, lawsuit loving, UN following, FBI abusing, IRS increasing, $200 hair cutting, gas taxing, over regulating, bureaucracy trusting, class baiting, privacy violating, values crushing, truth dodging, Medicare forsaking, property rights taking, job destroying, friends, and that's just in the White House.
In the wildest dreams of Buddy and Helen White, did they ever think that the fifth child born to them of six children in a poor rural community of Eufaula, Oklahoma, in a poor black neighborhood on the east side of the tracks, never in their wildest dreams did they ever think that their son, Junior, would someday grow up to be called Congress.
Bob Dole, as you know, was born in Kansas in a small town of Kansas. His
to carry the word to every man, woman, and child of every color and background that today, on the eve of the new American century, it's time to renew the American promise and to recapture the American dream and to give our nation a new birth of freedom with liberty, equality, and justice for all. That's what it means to be a Republican.
Age has its advantages. Let me be the bridge to an America that only the unknowing call myth. Let me be the bridge to a time of tranquility, faith, and confidence in action. And to those who say it was never so, that America has not been better, I say you're wrong. And I know because I was there, and I have seen it, and I remember. Nation, though wounded and scathed, has outlasted revolution, civil war, world war, racial oppression, and economic catastrophe. We have fought and prevailed on almost every continent and in almost every sea. We have even lost, but we have lasted, and we have always come through. And what enabled us to accomplish this has little to do with the values of the present. After decades of assault upon what made America great, upon supposedly obsolete values, what have we reaped? What have we created? What do we have? What we have, in the opinion of millions of Americans, is crime and drugs, illegitimacy, abortion, the abdication of duty, and the abandonment of children. And after the virtual devastation of the American family, the rock upon this country, on which this country was founded, we are told that it takes a village, that is, collective and thus the state, to raise a child. The state is now more involved than it ever has been in the raising of children. And children are now more neglected, more abused, and more mistreated than they have been in our time. This is not a coincidence. This is not a coincidence. And with all due respect, I am here to tell you, it does not take a village to raise a child. It takes a family to raise a child.
When all was said and done, this was perhaps the best organized and most TV-friendly political convention in American history. Republicans enjoyed a huge 10-point bounce in the polls immediately following their convention, but even with that, they were still behind. The 1996 Democrat convention was held in Chicago, Illinois, the week of August 26th. The week prior, President Clinton had embarked on a whistle-stop campaign that took him from West Virginia, across the Midwest, and into Illinois. By the time he reached Chicago, nothing that hinted at liberalism was left hanging on him. The Democrats, sensing re-election for the first time since FDR, kept the theme for the week simple. Remind Americans of the strong economy, give the president all the credit, and refer to Bob Dole and the GOP Congress as too extreme.
Jim, we must have made a wrong turn. This isn't San Diego.
I told you, this is the Democrat convention.
Every year in this country, nearly 40,000 Americans are killed with a firearm. More than 100,000 are wounded. Every 2 hours, another child is killed with a firearm. And with each death, and each wound, another American dream, another American family is shattered. This must stop.
Now, of course, we have to balance the budget. And we will. We have to be extremely careful with every dollar we spend. But we've also got to take care of our family. And not slash programs that people need. We should be enabling and healing and curing.
So yes, we must give our president a Democratic Congress. We need to ring every doorbell, buttonhole every voter, get out every vote. We need to work as we have never done before between now and November 5th to take the Congress back from Newt Gingrich and the Republicans, because ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, the Republicans are the real threat. They are the real threat to our women. They are the real threat to our children. They are the real threat to clean water, clean air, and the rich landscape of America. They are the real threat to fairness. They are the real threat to equality. The Republicans are the real threat to an enlightened Supreme Court.
For Bill and me, there has been no experience more challenging, more rewarding, and more humbling than raising our daughter. And we have learned that to raise a happy, healthy, and hopeful child, it takes a family. It takes teachers. It takes clergy. It takes business people. It takes community leaders. It takes those who protect our health and safety. It takes all of us. It takes a village.
This is some crowd. I've been watching you doing that Macarena on television. And if I could have your silence, I would like to demonstrate for you. The Al Gore version of the Macarena. Would you like to see it again? The president's opponent, Senator Bob Dole, is a good and decent man. We honor his service to America and his personal courage in fighting back from injuries sustained in battle. Though we disagree with his ideas, only the unknowing would deny him the respect he deserves. But make no mistake, there is a profound difference in outlook between the president and the man who seeks his office. In his speech from San Diego, Senator Dole offered himself as a bridge to the past. Tonight, Bill Clinton and I offer ourselves as a bridge to the future.
Look at the facts. Just look at the facts. 4.4 million Americans now living in a home of their own for the first time. Hundreds of thousands of women have started their own new businesses. More minorities own businesses than ever before. Record numbers of new small businesses and exports. Look at what's happened. We have the lowest combined rates of unemployment, inflation, and home mortgages in 28 years. Look at what happened. 10 million new jobs, over half of them high-wage jobs. 10 million workers getting the raise they deserve with the minimum wage law. 25 million people now having protection in their health insurance because the Kennedy-Kassebaum bill says you can't lose your insurance anymore when you change jobs, even if somebody in your family's been sick. 40 million Americans with more pension security. A tax cut for 15 million of our hardest pressed Americans and all small businesses. 12 million Americans, 12 million of them, taking advantage of the family and medical leave law so they can be good parents and good workers. 10 million students have saved money on their college loans. We are making our democracy work.
The Democrats received a smaller bounce in the polls after their convention than the Republicans had, but then again, they didn't need that big of a bounce. As Labor Day approached, Clinton was back to a 12 to 15 point lead. As summer gave way to autumn, the political landscape was now set for the fall classic. By October, Bob Dole had adopted much of Steve Forbes and Jack Kemp's supply-side agenda, but his proposal to slash taxes 15% bumped against his long insistence on cutting the deficit first. Dole seemed more wishy-washy than the president, who was becoming a model of constancy. After signing a welfare reform bill into law that he had previously vetoed on two occasions, Dole asked, "Is there anything we're for that he won't jump on?" The answer, essentially, was no. The two presidential debates changed no one's minds. All that lingers from these events is the memory of Dole's pillow punches, particularly in the final debate, and Clinton's skill at ignoring them. The one vice presidential debate will probably be remembered for Jack Kemp's totally unprepared and lackluster performance, perhaps ending any dreams of his to someday again seek the presidency.
Mr. President, what do you say to Senator Dole's point that this election is about keeping one's word?
Let's look at that. When I ran for president, I said we'd cut the deficit in half in 4 years. We cut it by 60%. I said that our economic plan would produce 8 million jobs. We have 10.5 million new jobs. We're number one in autos again, record numbers of new small businesses. I said we'd pass a crime bill that would put 100,000 police on the street, ban assault weapons, and deal with the problems that ought to be dealt with capital punishment, including capital punishment for drug kingpins. And we did that. I said we would change the way welfare works, and even before the bill passed, we'd move nearly 2 million people from welfare to work, working with states and communities. I said we'd get tougher on child support, and child support enforcement's up 50%. I said that I would work for tax relief for middle-class Americans. The deficit was bigger than I thought it was going to be, and I think they're better off, all of us are, that we got those interest rates down and the deficit down. Republicans talk about it, but we're the first administration in anybody's lifetime looking at this program to bring that deficit down 4 years in a row. We still gave tax cuts to 15 million working Americans, and now I've got a plan that's been out there for 2 years. It could have been passed already, but instead the Republicans shut the government down to try to force their budget and their plan on me, and I couldn't take that. But we'll get the rest of that tax relief. And so I think when you can look at those results, you know that the plan I've laid out for the future has a very good chance of being enacted if you'll give me a chance to build that bridge to the 21st century.
Senator?
Well, there he goes again. I mean, it's a line that's been used before, but exaggerating all the things that he did. He didn't do all these things. Let's take all these four years in a row. He came in with a high growth rate. The 1990 budget agreement, which some, didn't like, had some very tough cost controls, put a lot of pressure on Congress. The S&L crisis was over. They're starting to sell assets. All that money was coming in. And he cut defense an extra $60 billion, threw a lot of people out of work. He talks about a smaller government. There are actually more people in government, except for people in defense-related jobs. They're gone. The government's bigger than it was when President Kennedy was around. No, he says it's not. In addition, the Republican Congress cut $53 billion. So let's give credit where credit is due. Governor Engler in Michigan cut taxes 21 times, created a lot of new jobs. So did Governor Thompson. So did Governor Rowland. And a lot of people out there deserve credit, Mr. President. When I'm President of the United States, we're going to have a governor's council. And we're going to go work directly with the governors, Republicans and Democrats, to get power back to the people and back to the states.
Mr. Vice President, Mr. Kemp has accused you of demagoguery.
Well, as I said before, he used much harsher language when he talked about Bob Dole. He said that Bob Dole's solution for every single problem was to increase taxes. He said just 2 years ago that the Bob Dole tax increase of 1982 was the largest tax increase in the history of the world. But let's get to the point. Medicare has been adjusted 23 times since it was created in 1965. Bob Dole, incidentally, just bragged this year that he was one of only 12 people who voted against the creation of Medicare in the first place. I don't think he didn't believe in it then. And the plan that he promoted last year would have certainly been devastating to Medicare. Again, don't take my word for it. The American Hospital Association said it could have closed 700 hospitals. The Catholic Health Association, the AARP, and many other groups who pay careful attention to Medicare said that the Dole-Gingrich plan on Medicare would have led to deep cuts, possibly set up a two-tiered system and would have ended the kind of Medicare system that we have. Our plan extends Medicare 10 years into the future. We will always protect Medicare within the context of a balanced budget plan.
Folks, they have no plan. They have absolutely no plan. The president himself suggested that the reduction in the growth of Medicare over the next 5 or 6 years ought to be held to 6% under the Republican plan. Irrespective of the numbers, it will grow at 7% or even more. But that is beside the point. What has to be discussed is how we as a nation are going to create the size of an economy, create a national wealth that would at least double this $6 or $7 trillion economy. We would have $6 trillion in 15 years extra wealth for the American people, another $1 trillion of revenue with which to save Medicare and Social Security. And you can't do it with a tax code and a regulatory code and people suing each other with frivolous suits as this administration is allowing to happen. That has to change, and it will under Bob Dole and Jack Kemp.
Honor, duty, and country. That's what America is all about. Certainly the President of the United States, in the highest office in the world, the most important office in the world, has a responsibility to young people, as we talked about earlier, to everyone, by example. And when it comes to public ethics, he has a responsibility. When you have 30-some in your administration who either left or being investigated or in jail or whatever, then you've got an ethical problem. It's public ethics. I'm not talking about private. We're talking about public ethics. When you have 900 files gathered up by some guy who was a bouncer in a bar and hired a security officer to collect files in Watergate, I know a person who went to jail for looking at one file, one FBI file. There are 900 sequestered in the White House. 900 people like you. Why should they be rifling through your files? So the president has a great responsibility. And it's one that I understand and certainly carry out.
This is the most religious great country in history. And yet, interestingly enough, we have the most religious freedom of any country in the world, including the freedom not to believe. And now we have all these people just up the road in Los Angeles County. We've got people from 150 different racial and ethnic groups, and they've got tons of different religions. But the fundamental tenets of virtually every religion are the same. And what I've tried to do is to support policies that would respect religion and then help parents inculcate those values to their children. Let me very briefly give you some examples. One of my proudest moments was signing the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, which says the government's got to bend over backwards before we interfere with religious practice. So I changed the Justice Department effort to get a church to pay back a man's tithe because he was bankrupt when he gave it. I've supported character education programs in our schools, drug-free schools programs. I've supported giving parents a V-chip on their television so if they don't want their young kids to watch things they shouldn't watch, they wouldn't have to. That's the kind of thing we need to do. Give people like you and our families the power to give those values to our children.
Well, I think it's, before I came in, and my wife and daughter and I had a prayer, because it's God's will, whatever happens, it's God's will, it will happen. A constitutional amendment for voluntary prayer in school, in my view, would be a great idea. I support it, the president opposes it. And it seems to me the president, whoever the president may be, this is one of his highest responsibilities. People look to the president of the United States more than any other person in America. And that's the way it's always been, and that's the way it always will be.
With his economic package actually losing him support, Dole then swung at Clinton for a rise in drug use among youngsters. But as quickly as he raised the issue, he dropped it. He then said Clinton had no core. And when that didn't work, he labeled him an old-fashioned liberal. But that didn't work either. Scandal was left, so Dole tried reminding voters of Whitewater, FBI files, and foreign contributions as examples of Clinton's lack of a moral compass. But most voters, the polls found, had long since concluded that while inherently untrustworthy, Bill Clinton was nevertheless trustworthy enough for the White House. The Clinton campaign, as we've seen, had run negative TV ads linking Bob Dole to Newt Gingrich for over a year. This forced the Dole campaign to experiment with a variety of negative spots as they tried to find that one key issue that would hook the American people.
And let me say to you that I am honored to have been given the opportunity to stand up for the values and the interests of ordinary Americans. My job as president is to take care of the American people. And I have done my best to take good care of this country. We are safer, we are more secure, we are more prosperous. But in the end, what we stand for, the values we embrace and the things we fight for, will shape the future that we will all live with. If we hold out our hands in cooperation, but always stand up for what we know is right, this country's future will be even brighter than its brilliant past. It is our responsibility to make that happen.
Today, taxes are the highest in American history. Bill Clinton says we have the healthiest economy in three decades. Believe that? America can do better. Bob Dole, Jack Kemp, cutting income taxes on every family 15%, a $500 per child tax credit, higher take-home pay. Bob Dole, cut taxes, grow the economy, fight for what's right, tell the truth. Bob Dole, the better man for a better America.
The spirit of America. You can see it in how far we've come, but also in where we are going. Toward a future where our government is smaller and our economy even stronger. Where families are secure and our children cared for. And where the work ethic is alive and well. This is the America not of our dreams, but of our making. President Clinton, meeting our challenges, protecting our values.
The stakes of this election? Our children. Under Clinton, cocaine and heroin use among teenagers has doubled. Why? Because Bill Clinton isn't protecting our children from drugs. He cut the drug czar's office 83%, cut 227 drug enforcement agents, and cut $200 million to stop drugs at our borders. Clinton's liberal drug policies have failed. Our children deserve better.
It's sad. All Bob Dole offers are negative attacks. President Clinton is fighting drugs, appointing a four-star general drug czar. Dole voted against even creating the Office of Drug Czar. President Clinton strengthened school anti-drug programs. Dole Gingrich tried to slash him 50%. President Clinton expanded the death penalty for drug kingpins, now wants drug testing to keep abusers locked up. President Clinton, endorsed by the largest police organization for fighting crime, protecting our values.
The truth about Clinton on taxes? Remember?
I will not raise taxes on the middle class.
But he gave the middle class the largest tax increase in history. Higher taxes on your salary, gasoline, Social Security. Clinton even tried higher taxes on heating your home. 255 proposed tax and fee increases in all. Clinton says...
But I don't think that qualifies me as a clause.
Sorry, Mr. Clinton. Actions do speak louder than words. The real Bill Clinton. A real spend and tax liberal.
Recession, hard times. Bob Dole votes to deny families unemployment benefits.
The economy was never that bad.
10 million unemployed, higher interest rates. 4 years later, unemployment 7-year low. 10 million new jobs. We make more autos than Japan. The president, growth and opportunity. $1,500 tax credit for college, a $500 per child tax credit, expanded family and medical leave, a balanced budget. Building a bridge to the 21st century.
Does the truth matter?
Now, I will tell you this. I will not raise taxes on the middle class.
He gives us the largest tax increase in American history.
The era of big government is over.
He gives us a massive government-run health care system.
Everybody knows that I have tougher ethics rules than any previous president.
More investigations, more prosecutions, more convictions. And the list goes on and on. Does the truth matter? Does it matter to you?
With the economy holding strong and America at peace, Bill Clinton never broke a sweat during the fall. His lead in the polls remained constant. Near the end, a frustrated Dole struck out at the media for being too liberal, and at voters in general for failing to wake up to Clinton's shortcomings. As desperation set in, Dole's down-ticket colleagues fled their leader, which was a smart move. The GOP's ability to retain control of the Congress resulted, at least in part, from arguing that the president's second-term plans should be checked by a Republican legislature, just as the president had gained greatly from avowing that he was needed to check them. On Election Day, there were little surprises. Clinton would beat Dole by 8 points in the popular vote and receive 379 electoral votes to Dole's 159.
In the state of Arizona, big win for Bill Clinton. That's the first time since 1948 that a Democrat has carried that state. It's the home of Barry Goldwater, of course, who at one point said this year that he preferred Bill Clinton over Bob Dole, later said, well, that was just a joke. A lot of people thought that maybe he was expressing his sincere beliefs in Bill Clinton. So that's a big win in the Southwest for Bill Clinton. It gives him a very secure base in that part of the country. 375 electoral votes now. Tim, it's hard to overstate the scope of the victory that is beginning to take shape for Bill Clinton tonight.
Arizona is very significant, Tom. 1948, that's a long time.
Well, a lot of old people live down there in Sun City and other places, and Medicare was a huge issue.
Medicare. And don't forget, Steve Forbes in the Republican primaries spent $3 million in negative advertising against Bob Dole in Arizona. And obviously, it still resonates and held there at a very negative image for Bob Dole with a lot of swing voters.
You've been a constant source of inspiration for Elizabeth and myself. But I might add, you're not going to get that tax cut if you don't be quiet. Yeah. And I would say to the young people and all the others involved, it's a lot more fun winning. It hurts to lose an election. But stay involved and keep fighting the good fight, because you are the ones who will make the 21st century the next American century.
Prior to this election, in the entire history of our nation, from the presidency of George Washington forward, only 13 people have been elected to two straight terms as President of the United States of America. Six of them have been Democrats, one of history's short lists. But tonight, to the names of Thomas Jefferson, James Madison, James Monroe, Andrew Jackson, Woodrow Wilson, and Franklin Delano Roosevelt, we add a seventh name. The name of your president, my friend, President William Jefferson Clinton.
Good evening, everyone. You're listening to Al Gore, and this is 12 News Tonight.
Let's go back to Arkansas.
Century of great challenge and unlimited possibility. Now we've got a bridge to build, and I'm ready if you are.
President of the United States of America awards the Presidential Medal of Freedom to Bob Dole. From foreign battlefields to the halls of Congress, Bob Dole has served his country with courage, dedication, and grace. Overcoming his own adversity, he rose to become a champion for the disabled and America's farmers, for preserving Social Security and promoting fiscal responsibility, and for strengthening our global leadership for freedom, peace, and prosperity. A man of the heartland, he brought common sense, uncommon skill, and a prairie wit to the United States Senate, where he was the longest-serving Republican leader in history. Soldier, statesman, and patriot, Bob Dole has created a record of achievement that will stand forever as a tribute to the strengths and values that have made America great.
Thank you very much. I, Robert J. Dole. Do solemnly swear. Sorry, wrong speech. Mr. President, Mr. Vice President, Mrs. Clinton, Elizabeth and I join me in wishing you and Mrs. Clinton, Vice President Mrs. Gore, all the best as you embark on your second term. May God bless you and each inhabitant of this house, and may God bless America.
Bob Dole's weakness as a candidate in 1996 was not that he was unpopular. Actually, his favorability rating stayed in the mid to upper 50s throughout the entire fall. Rather, it was that he and his campaign lacked the rationale and issues needed for a challenger to unseat an incumbent president during good economic times. This is precisely why Clinton's lead was never seriously challenged throughout the fall campaign, and why salvo after salvo from Dole fell upon deaf ears. Would another candidate have fared better against Bill Clinton than Bob Dole in 1996? Possibly. But would a harsher, more direct campaign against Bill Clinton's character have attracted more women voters to the GOP? Probably not. The campaign of 96 proves that Mark Twain was right when he said, "History doesn't repeat itself, but it rhymes." The economy was strong, consumer confidence was up, the nation was at peace, and the incumbent president won. Yes, indeed. History does rhyme. For America's Choice 96, I'm Jim Heath. Thanks for joining us.
So remember to subscribe to the Jim Heath channel and hit that like button. Thank you for watching.